Welcome back to the show. I'm looking forward to this. It's been a whirlwind few days for Anthony Albanese, elected on Saturday night, sworn in as Prime Minister on Sunday, then straight on a plane to Tokyo to meet world leaders. He's back on our home soil now and joins us. Good morning to you, Prime Minister. On behalf of us all here at Today Show and our viewers, congratulations.
Good morning, Carl. It's great to be back on the Today Show.
It's been a little bit of time, a week or so.
With a different title.
That's it. Very different title, different life. Can you talk us through the last 5 days? Wow.
Oh, it's been quite extraordinary. We had Saturday night. I had at my place. I'm here in Marrickville. And I had a very small group of people there, three people from my office, Tim Gartrell, my chief, Liz, the head of my media operation, Katie Connolly, who was doing the strategy, and I had Jody, of course, was there. My son Nathan was the most nervous in the room.
Wow.
And Penny Wong. And I cooked dinner for people on Saturday night. People think that's pretty crazy, but I cooked some pasta. It was pretty simple pasta with a pretty basic sort of arrabbiata sauce, just to get going. A bit of comfort food, I find. And then we had it was clear that we had one. I received a phone call from Scott Morrison. Conceding the election, and we went to Canterbury Helston Park RSL. I was determined to not go to one of the big city hotels. It was good to do it at a local club. And then, of course, Monday we got sworn in Monday morning at 9 a.m. because the Quad Leaders meeting was so important that Australia be represented there, and it was a great honour to represent Australia with President Biden, our host, Prime Minister Kishida, and Prime Minister Modi.
Okay.
I was very warmly welcomed there.
I'll get onto that in just a second. I just wanted to take you back to Saturday night if we can, because, I mean, at some point you do know that you've become the Prime Minister of the country. Someone says something, or it's the call from Scott Morrison. What was that like when you know that everything that you've gone towards your whole life becomes a reality?
It was quite an extraordinary moment, and it was overwhelming. Paul Erickson was in the count room, my campaign director. They had a set-up in at the National Campaign Office. I deliberately didn't do that. I wanted to just spend some time at home. I was determined not to get ahead of myself over the last 3 years. We know that polls can be wrong. But it was clear to me that I thought during the campaign I couldn't see how the coalition could get to 76 seats. The question was what the outcome would be, though, whether we would be a majority Labor government, which it appears likely that we will be. But it was clear to me that we would be in a position to form government reasonably early on in the night, but we were awaiting those results. It's always a bit of a roller coaster, of course. Seats get allocated one way and then another, but we know now that we'll be in, I think, a very strong position to govern and to implement the agenda that we put forward. It was very emotional for me, Carl. It was emotional thinking about my journey in life, which, when you grow up the way that I did with a single mum in public housing, the expectation on your career path is not to rise to the position of Prime Minister. But it does say a lot about our great country that people can have that opportunity. I did have a couple of draft speeches, Carl. I had a shorter one and then a longer one. And in the end, I sat on the lounge and I basically dictated the speech that I gave, not word for word, of course, but pretty close to it. I dictated with Katie Connolly, was actually sitting on the floor with a laptop just typing it in.
Wow.
Because I wanted it to be my voice when I stood up at the RSL. I wanted it to be my voice that was out there. I hope that one of the tasks of being Prime Minister will be to stay authentic. The 3 years that I was leader of the Labor Party from opposition, I tried to make sure that, you know, I am who I am. As you know, Carl, we've known each other for a long period of time, and I think that was important, that it be my voice on Saturday night.
Okay.
And it was.
You know, you're 100% right. I mean, I just can't imagine the emotions there. Your mum looking down. I would imagine that would have been something you thought of as well. And then,
absolutely. Last night, Carl, when I touched down from Tokyo, yesterday was the 20th anniversary of my mum's death.
Oh.
And I travelled last night out to the cemetery to see her and to have a chat.
Oh man.
It was a big deal.
Oh man. Thank you for sharing that. That's a big deal. And those emotions would have been
It was a private moment.
Yeah.
I went by myself, but I just felt like, you know, I hope that it gives people out there, whether they be single mums or people going through difficulties in life and their children, I hope that my journey does give people a bit of an uplift, you know, because it's not about me. No one gets there, as I said on Saturday night, no one gets there by themselves. You get there because people believe in you, because people provide you with support. The neighbours who cooked me meals when I was there as a school student, looking after me, that sense of community that was there in Camperdown, the sense of feel that was there on Saturday night when we came out of the house and my neighbours here in Marrickville, like it was reasonably late, I'm not sure what time it was, it was, you know, around about 11 o'clock or thereabouts, and it was like the whole neighbourhood were on the street just cheering. The change in direction for this country, and one of the things that I want to bring to change is not just policy change but culture change. I want to change the way that politics operates in this country. Right. I want it to be more inclusive. I want it to be more respectful.
Look, I've got a little bit of time left with you, and I'm going to utilise it in a very long way. So sorry for the delays for everyone out there. Here's a kid from Marrickville. You stand up. You're named as Prime Minister, sworn in as Prime Minister, in front of Jody and in front of your boy, Nathan. That journey alone is worth talking about at some other point. Then you get on a plane and this kid from Marrickville's on the world stage with Joe Biden. And I don't know, do you get nervous? Are you worried about even slipping on the stairs coming down the plane? Like, how does that all work for you? I mean, that is a mind warp of transitions.
Well, it's a big deal. and I think it's really helped the government, I've got to say, to have hit the ground running. The world knows there's a change of government in Australia. And whether it be our neighbours in the Indo-Pacific or our friends in Europe or other parts of the world, it's been incredibly well received, I've got to say.
Yeah.
Whether it was Prime Minister Johnson or I had a chat with Justin Trudeau yesterday, we've had a chat with a range of world leaders. All of them have been welcoming.
Yeah.
They've been very supportive of the message that we've sent out that Australia will now join global action on climate change, and I look forward to re-engaging. The next visit will be up to Indonesia, and that will be important as well.
The news is pressing very heavily over my shoulders, but a couple of quick ones as Prime Minister. Look, China's obviously an issue. They've already thrown shade on Japan in the last 24 hours. Is Penny Wong enough to stop Beijing signing a deal with 10 more Pacific nations potentially signing up?
Well, these are sovereign nations, of course, and this has been well underway. And the truth is that the government dropped the ball. There was a submission last year, we know now, for increased aid, for example, to the Pacific, from the Foreign Minister, Maurice Payne, supported by the Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, that was rejected by the government. It's extraordinary. It's very clear that China is seeking to extend its influence into what has been since the Second World War, the region of the world where Australia has been the security partner of choice. Penny Wong is on her way to Fiji. That's just the start of a re-engagement with the Pacific. I'll attend the Pacific Island Forum in coming weeks when it's held at schedule for July at this point in time. It's important that we implement as well. We put forward a comprehensive policy on Pacific re-engagement at the election. We'll set about implementing that as a matter of urgency and reaching out to our Pacific Island friends and making sure that they know that Australia wishes to continue to be the security partner of choice, okay, but also partners in dealing with their economic growth and with climate change.
Would it surprise you if I got a message from your son Nathan saying, let's get on the cans at Kirribilli now that Dad's got the keys?
That's very possible, mate. That's very possible.
It didn't happen.
He's a good lad.
Yeah.
He did have... He was a bit nervous on Saturday night. He had a couple of beers before we headed off to the RSL. The rest of us were being very very responsible. Mm. It's got to be said, in spite of the pressure that was there on Saturday. But he's a good lad. But I'm not sure I want you and I'm not sure the world is ready for Carl and Nathan to get together on
the
cans.
Not.
You can't stop progress. Thanks, PM. All the very best. Thank you. All right, let's get the news. Sorry I'm late, Alex.
I, for one, would like to say that.